Hello, my name is Rainer Hanekamp, and this is a special summer edition of NG News covering all the events of the Angular community from the end of July to the end of August. In the July edition of the Angular Q&A session, the hosts Mark Thompson and Jeremy Elborn were joined by another Angular member, namely Jessica Chinook. Jessica gave some insights about the ongoing work in terms of hydration. Jeremy mentioned some behind-the-scenes work.
Will HTTP client always only return observables?
We are actively prototyping some ideas for how to have kind of a data story with signals. It probably won't be just like taking the existing HTTP client and saying, here's a signal instead of an observable, because we want to do something that's a little bit more from the ground up.
Ryan Carniato, the creator of SolidJS, this is a framework which brought signals into the spotlight, published a three-part article series under the name Derivations of Reactivity. In the first part, Ryan dives into the concepts of the push and pull mechanisms and how their combination plays out in signals. He emphasized that using derivations or computed values in Angular ensures that work is only done once. In contrast, relying on side effects might lead to multiple executions. The second part addressed the challenges with scheduling. Should we run them lazily or eagerly? And its implications, especially on the garbage collection. The third part looks into the future and explores concepts like asynchronous signals. Currently, a signal holding an asynchronous value must be of type undefined and the type of the eventual value. But in the future, the framework might handle this more gracefully, automatically managing the potential undefined state until the value is ready. This could give us a hint about this future development in terms of HTTP client and signals that Jeremy mentioned in the Q&A session. Armin Fardanyan, the author of the book Modern Angular, published an in-depth article on AngularSpace. This article is about directives and how we can extend their potential by combining them with dependency injection. AngularSpace, by the way, is a website with free membership where you can provide articles that are reviewed by some community members. Armin's article titled Superpower with Directives and Dependency Injection isn't just theoretical, it's quite the opposite. He starts with the basics of directives and then walks you through more advanced concepts using practical real-world examples that you might want to incorporate into your own projects. And the Angular Vienna meetup took place with quite some interesting talks. For example, about architecture from Robert Meyer Sildorf or issues with barrel files from Wojtek Maszek. Matej Czok presented Code Pushup. This is a quality tool very similar to SonarQube, but specialized for the needs of a front-end application. It analyzes projects in four key categories by default: ESLint, code coverage, security, and performance via Lighthouse. In short, Code Pushup helps us to manage technical debt and also to get rid of it. Julian Jandl also gave an in-depth talk about the tool PartyTown. This allows us to delegate heavy computation from the main thread to web workers, which means they run in parallel without blocking the application. The real magic is that these scripts can still access the DOM and send requests despite the usual constraints that come with web workers. Julian's talk was based on a real-world experience with BVIM, that's a betting platform, and they were facing issues with Google Analytics, Tag Manager, etc. The recordings from an Angular Austrian meetup, namely Graz, are available as well. That meetup featured quite insightful talks from different experts like Manfred Steyer, Fabian Gosebrink, and Dariusz Kalbarczyk. And additionally, there have also been two talks from two members of the Angular team. Emma Twersky provided a broad overview of the current state of Angular and its future roadmap. She highlighted ongoing work and research on exciting topics like streaming and selectorless components, which aim to simplify the development process by potentially removing the need for imports for components. Mathieu Riegler also presented at this meetup, diving into the concepts of going zoneless. Traditionally, Angular with ZoneJS was aware of the asynchronous tasks and when they end. This is especially important for server-side rendering when we know that the application is not ready and can be sent to the browser. Mathieu showcased experimental services like the pending task service, which is able to track asynchronous tasks. Existing services from Angular, like the HTTP client, use it already.
You have some other APIs that are asynchronous, and you want to tell, okay, I want to tell Angular, I am not ready, I am doing some work that needs to maintain the app as unstable. And when the task is done, you can just clean up, the pending task with calling the function that has been returned by the app.
Angular 18.2 has been released. The main features this time is around migration scripts. One of them takes your constructors, which make use of dependency injection, and replace them with the inject function. That doesn't mean that constructor-based dependency injection is not supported anymore, but it gives us a subtle hint where the Angular team is leaning towards. Another migration script is for lazy loaded routes for standalone components. If your route configuration uses the load component property, you can now have it automatically set up for lazy loading. On the testing front, in the past when we were using fake async, it was required that no asynchronous tasks are running when the test ends. Now there is an option that Angular automatically flushes those asynchronous tasks for us. Interestingly, the official Angular blog post highlighted a completely different feature, the isolated modules option in TypeScript. This setting can potentially improve the build time when you're using the application builder. For more details, please check out the official blog post. The Angular Q&A session, August edition, also took place. This time it was a little bit different, because it became very quickly clear that Jeremy was on a special mission, namely to deliver the ultimate testing guide. Jeremy argued that when we do tests,
you want your tests to be as representative of real life as is practical.
That might also challenge some common definitions we might have for the term unit test.
That reminds me of an integration test style.
Yes, it is much more aligned with the way people have historically written integration tests.
When it comes to dependencies, services, then it might not be necessary to replace them. We can use the originals as well. If it comes to replacement, so the test doubles, then we have two options.
One is called a mock, and one is called a fake. What I'm creating right here with this Jasmine spy, this is a mock. A mock is something that keeps track of the APIs that you're calling and when you called them, how many times you called them, what parameters you set when you called them. A fake is basically it's not a better way of saying this, is like a fake implementation of a thing.
So the rule set for choosing it is, first, don't try to replace services at all. Try to come up with a fake. And third, use a mock. And that was it for the summer edition. I hope you enjoyed the summer. And now let's go back to work, and we'll continue with engine news in the next week. Until then, goodbye.